Welcome back to Whence Came You, a Freemasonic podcast featuring research papers and discussions related to Freemasonry. I'm your host, Brother Robert Johnson. So in the news this week, a new Masonic radio theater is underway. It is a Christmas special, and I hope you guys all enjoy that. Keep your eyes peeled for that. Of course, the release will be released on all of the social media sites like Facebook and Twitter. So make sure you follow at Whence Came You and also at Masonic Radio Theater. I hope you guys all liked the latest episode of the Masonic Roundtable about the Swedish Rite. They have some really interesting customs there. I think it is a flavor of Masonry that many enjoy. However, it does have some interesting points over in the Swedish Rite, which if you guys didn't get to listen to, the Swedish Rite is practiced primarily in Finland, Denmark, Iceland, Sweden, of course. Over there, it's a Christian-only order. I guess yes and no on that. There are some jurisdictional differences within the order. They don't have a lot of the same things we have here in the States. I think we're a little bit more free with our Masonry here in the United States, not to take anything away from the Swedish Rite or to take anything away from the quote-unquote American Rite of Freemasonry, but there are definitely some differences between the two. So if you didn't get a chance to check that out, head on over to YouTube and you can watch that. I think it's episode 44 and it's also on iTunes as well. Just to give you guys a heads up, there was a time with the Masonic Roundtable where it would be a couple weeks before we got each episode up because of the bandwidth issue. That is gone. So now, basically within an hour of a show ending that was live, it goes up on iTunes. You can check those out as they publish. So this week was an interesting week for me. I read a paper. And this paper was really cool for me, particularly because I had read what the paper was about. And I kind of struggled a bit whether or not I was going to bring it up on the show or not. And by bring it up, I mean read the paper on the show. So I decided that I am going to read it. And it's a piece which might be out of order for some of our listeners. And this is because it is a piece about a book which many brothers have read called Born in Blood. Now, this piece will not ruin anything for you if you have not read that book, but if after this piece your palate has been tantalized, perhaps it might be time to go out and get that book, Born in Blood, and give it a good read. So this week's paper is called More About Born in Blood, and it's from Summer 91 edition of the Missouri The Freemason by John C. Allen, Past Master, Pleasant Grove, Lodge Number 42, Otterville, Missouri. And we'll go right into that right now. More about Born in Blood. In the summer issue of this year's Freemason appeared a review by Zell Eaton of the book Born in Blood by John J. Robinson. I am prompted to write this article by a conclusion drawn by Mr. Robinson about the origin of Freemasonry. In his review, Mr. Eaton alludes to this aspect of the book only vaguely. I am referring to Mr. Robinson's theory that modern Masonry actually had its origin from the Knights Templar, outlawed in 1312 by Pope Clement V and the French King Philip the Fair. It was Mr. Robinson's conclusion that the Templars not only apprehended, went underground to escape the heavy hand of the papacy, and then resurfaced centuries later as lodges of Freemasons. Most traditional Masonic research, of course, have contended that the order and its rituals somehow developed from the early crude organizations of the stonemason labor guilds. I, for one, have never been able to accept that view. Several years ago, I arrived independently at the same conclusion as Mr. Robinson. Are Masonic rituals steeped, as it is, in Kabbalistic occultism and mystery ceremonials of the Middle East could never possibly have been developed out of the crude beginnings of the stonemason guilds. In that era, even the skilled artisans and their speculative associates were far too unlettered and unlearned to have been capable of coming up with anything as elaborate and esoteric as even the earliest forms of Masonic ritual. Knowledge of the Hebrew Kabbalah and the Middle Eastern mystery dramas had been ruthlessly suppressed by the papacy during the Dark Ages and could have returned to Western Europe only by way of the Crusades. For bringing it back, the Templars became the logical bridge. During their stay in the Holy Land, the Templars had come into close association with a Muslim sect called the Sufi, who previously had adopted many of the beliefs and ritualistic forms of the Gnostic or primitive Christians. From the Sufi, the Templars borrowed many of their own esoteric beliefs and ceremonials. A number of these have made their way into modern Freemasonry. One of these, for example, is the Junior Warden's call of the craft from labor to refreshment and from refreshment to labor, referring in a symbolic sense to death and rebirth. The Gnostic, the Sufi, and the Templars all believed in reincarnation. Is this view about Masonic origins born out by any prestigious Masonic scholars? Yes, it certainly is, by one of our most celebrated scholars, Brother Albert Pike. My readings in Brother Pike's Morals and Dogma have convinced me that Mr. Robinson, in his recent book, was on the right track. Jacques B. de Molay, the last Grand Master of the Knights Templar, according to Brother Pike, masterminded the plans for Freemasonry while he was awaiting execution. Before coming in unequivocally to that assertion, Brother Pike cited conclusive evidence that long before the Templars went underground, they considered themselves builders or masons and were even called by the English, though careless pronunciation, Freemasons. This is clearly shown by the following extract with reference to de Molay. Quote, "The Templars, or poor fellow soldiery of the Holy House of the Temple, intended to be rebuilt, took as their models in the Bible the warrior masons of Zerubbabel, who worked, holding the sword in one hand and the trowel in the other. Therefore, it was that the sword and the trowel became the insignia of the Templars, who subsequently concealed themselves under the name Brethren Masons. The name Frères Maçons in the French was corrupted in English into Freemasons. The trowel of the Templars is quadruple, and the triangular plates of it are arranged in the form of a cross, making a Kabbalistic pentacle, known by the name of the Cross of the East." End quote. On page 820 of Morals and Dogma, Brother Pike leaves no doubt that he considered Freemasonry the brainchild of Jacques de Molay, as this extract will indicate. But before his execution, the chief of the doomed order organized and instituted what afterward came to be called the occult, hermetic, or Scottish Masonry. In the gloom of his prison, the Grand Master created four metropolitan lodges, at Naples for the east, at Edinburgh for the west, and Stockholm for the north, and at Paris for the south. The initials of his name, JBM, found in the same order in the first 3 degrees, are but one of many internal and cognate proofs that such was the origin of modern Freemasonry. End quote. Brother Pike's reference to the initials, of course, is to some of the passwords in the degrees. Could this be mere coincidence? Brother Pike went on to say that, quote, "The legend of Osiris was revised and adopted as the central theme of the third degree ritual to symbolize the destruction of the order and the resurrection of Khurum, slain in the body of the temple of Khurum Abai, the master as the martyr of fidelity to obligation of truth and conscience," end quote. According to the legend of Osiris here referred to, as the fragments of God's body lay on the ground, a lion reached down with his paw, scooped up the pieces, and lifted them back again to erect in living form. In the new order succeeding the Templars, this served as a symbolism. The papacy and the king had slain the Grand Master but failed to accomplish their purpose. The Master Mason's grip triumphed over extinction. The prostrate corpse of the Knights Templar had been raised from death. Once again, it lived in the form of a new order. Freemasonry. The old order, vitally obsessed with building, lived on as builders still. The trowel remained still as its principal working tool. The Templars continued their role as quote-unquote Brethren Masons. Why are Freemasons so obsessed with the Holy Saints John? Quote, "Oh, the labor guilds were expected to have patron saints. The stonemasons adopted the Holy Saints John," end quote. We have all read that lame explanation. If a labor guild wanted patron saints, why would it choose two saints with contrasting religious beliefs? For the Knight Templar to do so was perfectly logical, as Brother Pike took note in Morals and Dogma. From their very inception, the Templars functioned as a dualistic order. Their avowed and pretended purpose was to protect Christians making pilgrimages to the Holy Land. Their actual and secret objective was to rebuild the Temple of King Solomon to recapture its original splendor and restore Jerusalem to the days of its pristine glory. In their outward aspects, they posed as loyal supporters of Orthodox Catholicism. This facade they craftily cultivated to gain the approval and sanction of the papacy. For this reason, they adopted John the Baptist as one of their patron saints. Saint John the Evangelist, however, was the one who had been regarded as the spokesman of the Gnostic religious views to which they adhered and wished to make supreme in their restored city of Jerusalem, designed by them secretly to displace Rome as the center of Christendom. Saint John the Evangelist, therefore, became the most cherished patron saint. If Freemasonry did indeed stem from the Templars, it is only natural that the Masons would also adopt both of these patron saints. Since the Templars' chief objective was the rebuilding of King Solomon's temple, one would reasonably expect them to contribute to continue in that preoccupation when they established a new order to succeed the Templars. Need there be any mystery, then, as to why Freemasonry is similarly obsessed with the same temple? The Templar connection would also nicely explain the mystery of the quote-unquote bloody Masonic obligations. If the Templars had any part in drafting these obligations, we would expect them to be fraught with dire consequences. We say today that the obligations are intended to be only symbolical. To a Templar member of the early guilds or lodges, they would not have been considered symbolical. A Templar was a marked man with a price on his head. The long arm of the papacy could reach him even in non-Catholic Scotland. Wherever he fled, there was always the threat of a hired assassin. He could take no chances of having his identity or activities revealed. Many of the other secrets of Freemasonry can be similarly accounted for as safeguarding the secrets or security of the Templars who probably dominated the earliest lodges. In one respect, perhaps the traditionalists were right. Perhaps Freemasonry did develop in and come down to us from the stonemason guilds of Scotland. Its concept and ritual, however, could not have been originated by the stonemasons per se. Perhaps the Templars who escaped to Scotland decided to infiltrate stonemason guilds and there introduce the system of de Molay's new order. They had very good reasons to do so. The Templars had also been builders or masons. In their heyday, the Templars had exerted complete control over not only the stonemasons, but also over all other skilled craftsmen throughout Western Europe. That being true, the Templars would obviously have experienced little difficulty in trying to infiltrate the guilds. As a final argument for the Templar connection, we should not forget the religious element. Freemasonry is regarded as a semi-religious order. If the Templars did really found Masonry, it would be surprising if they hadn't placed a very strong emphasis on religion, because the Knights Templar was instituted primarily as a religious order. All right, now comes the time in the show where I ask you to support it. So we have a few ways of doing so. If you visit wcypodcast.com, you'll see a link that says support the show, and you'll find many of these ways right there. First and foremost, we have our applications for your Android, Apple, or Windows phone. What these do is you get the papers that we read on the show via a PDF, kind of like an Easter egg or a bonus feature. You'll also get access to a wallpaper of a Masonic design designed just for your mobile device. And we try to make those fresh every single week for you so that you have a new wallpaper you can display. And maybe somebody at work will see your phone ringing and see the background image and get interested and ask you a question. Or maybe you just really like Freemasonry. Whatever the case is, those are there for you. Having the papers there at your fingertips is also a great thing. If you're a district education officer, if you are an education officer, or just in charge of some education at your local lodge meetings, it's a great resource to be able to just pull out your phone, pull out a paper, and give it a quick read, or skim them and give some of the bullet points there for your brethren. I'm sure they will enjoy. The second way, of course, is through shopping. So we all love shopping. In fact, we just released the Whence Came You Masonic Gift Guide for 2014. If you haven't got a copy of that, go ahead and check that out on wcypodcast.com, and you'll see a lot of the really cool things inside that gift guide that aren't necessarily just Masonic. They're gentlemanly products, so they're really neat stuff. And a few of the items in there we do have promo codes for. That promo code is WCY. So whether you're on FreemasonryArt.com and you want to check out some really awesome Masonic prints, or maybe you want to get an apron or one of Juan Sepulveda's brand new lapel pin display aprons, you can use the coupon code WCY and get a little percentage off, and he throws a little bit back to this show to help keep the lights on. Also, we have onnit.com. So if you click on the links on wcypodcast.com for Onnit, it'll take you to a really great website that has tons of stuff, healthy living supplements, things like Alpha Brain, which is a product I use myself, and it's amazing. You'll get 10% off, and they send a little bit back to the show also. Again, coupon code WCY. And of course, the third and most popular way to donate to the show is via our PayPal direct donation. This is the quickest and easiest way to donate to the program. And whether you donate $1 or $2, whatever it is, it goes directly right back into the show, and we use it for paying the bills of the hosting. So I appreciate all of your help there. And I should mention that we do have a page on wcypodcast.com now, which is kind of my little homage to the people who have repeatedly supported this show in a huge way. And these guys have all given the show a ton of support. So if you click on it, there is actually a support wall, and it's just a brick wall, and it has names on that wall of the brothers who have made significant donations to the show. And without you, this could not be possible. So it's an additional thank you to those gentlemen. So now we're going to go into this week's famous Freemason. So last week, we didn't have a famous Freemason. We were running a little bit long with the episode because of a great interview we had with Brother Charles Harper. But this week, we pulled one out from 1725, and he passed away in 1798. He was born Giovanni Jacopo in Venice, Italy. But you may know him better as Casanova, or Casanova de Singalt. He was of a family of actors. He was educated for the priesthood and showed brilliance of mind and wit, but was expelled for scandalous conduct from seminary of St. Cyprian in 1741. He then became secretary in the household of Cardinal Acquaviva, followed by a spell in the Venetian army at Corfu. He was by turn a preacher, able alchemist, kabbalist, gambler, and violin player. For 20 years he roamed Europe, alternatively in fortune and distress. Skeptic and sensualist, he was involved in one intrigue after another. He was imprisoned as a spy in Venice in 1755. As director of the state lotteries in Paris, he accumulated a fortune. He was an agent of Louis XV. He made acquaintances with the greats of his day, including the Pope, who bestowed him with the papal order of Golden Spur. He was alternatively forced to flee to Russia, France, Spain, and Italy. He is best known for his memoirs, which, although a cynical record of his rogueries and amours, is of great historical importance. He was thought to have entered Freemasonry in Lyons in 1750. The craft must have had a mighty appeal to his wild adventurer without morals, for scattered through his memoirs are numerous references to Freemasonry. He advised all young men, well-born, who wished to become of value in society to become Freemasons, even though it would only be to know superficially what it is. He defended the fraternity with unmeasured scorn from those who thought it political, anarchistic, and subversive. He asked young men to, quote-unquote, choose well the lodge, for though bad company cannot work in the lodge, it may, however, be found there, and the candidate ought to guard himself against its dangerous associations, end quote. What is really remarkable, however, is his reverent appreciation of the inner content of the art. He asserted that the real secrets of the fraternity were not in its symbols or words, but were to be found only in reflection, reason, comparison, and deduction. He averred that the secret of Freemasonry, discovered by the individual, cannot be imparted to another. Pretty interesting stuff. Anyway, that's it for this week. You can find us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at WhenceKMU. Check us out on Google+ at the email address wcypodcast@gmail.com. Alternatively, you can reach me either there or at admin@wcypodcast.com. Don't forget to check out the Masonic gift guide. There's still some time to grab some stuff before the holiday giving season. Hanukkah is right around the corner. Christmas is right around the corner. We've got great stuff in there, and I hope you guys all check it out. It's on Magster, it's on Issue, and it's also on wcypodcast.com as a blog post just down the page. You can click on it and print it out and give it out, or you can just maybe slyfully leave it on the counter at home when you go to work. Maybe your significant other will pick it up and catch the hint. Anyway, that's it for this week, guys. I will talk to you all next week. Stay on the level. The Whence KMU. I'm Robert Johnson.